panic stolen with music and song. For the Lord is a great God, a great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, he made it, and his hands, they form the dry land. Very good. That's Psalm 95. We just sang five verses of Psalm 95, okay? Come, let us sing with joy to the Lord. Why did God make us? What have we been saying? Why did God make us?
To seek and find him.
That's right. That's Acts 17.
To share his image.
To share his image. We say that one too, right? God made us to seek and find him. He made us to share his image. I like thinking of God as wanting to share. Is it good to share?
Yeah.
It is good to share, right? So think of somebody who's the best ever. The best and has all of the best. And all he wants to do is what? Is share it. That's right. God made us so that he could share himself, all of his goodness with us. What's our purpose? To glorify him, which is not hard to do because he's so great, right? To glorify, and then we get to enjoy him, right? To glorify him and to enjoy him. That's a great thing to do. What's success? What we've been saying success is living for
God and with him forever.
Very good. Living for God and living with him forever, right? Living with him here, living with him in heaven, living with him forever. So if that's success, then what is failure? Living for your... And without God forever. That's right. So failure then is just living for yourself, right? Living selfishly and living without God forever. I was reading something about that this morning in Proverbs. Okay, living selfishly. And why does any of this make sense? Why is it good for God to share himself? Why is it good for us to glorify him and enjoy him and to share him? Why? Because God is
so good.
That's right. Say it real loud. God is
so good.
That's right. Everybody say it with me. How good is God? Very good. I think we can do better than that, Willa. You think we can do better than that? How good is God? So good. There we go. God is so good. That's right. That's right. What cures worry? Jesus taught us that there's a cure for worry. He said, don't worry about your life, what you're going to eat, drink, or what you're going to wear. Okay, birds don't even have to worry about that. God takes care of them. He takes care of flowers. He said to seek something first, and that'll cure our worry. Seek what? Seek God first, right? Seek God and his kingdom first. You guys want to sing that with me? Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you, singing hallelujah, hallelujah. Jesus said, for this reason I tell you, not to worry about your life, what you're going to eat, drink, or wear, okay, but to seek him first, okay, put him first. What's the greatest command? The greatest command. We sing this one. What's the greatest command? To love. Very good, very good. Brenna got it. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart. So I called you Brenna, didn't I? Brooklyn got it. You shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and all of your might. Deuteronomy 6:5. Very good. You got it. What's the second greatest commandment, Brooklyn?
To love your neighbor as yourself.
She's on it today, Mom and Dad. She's on it. Very good. The second greatest commandment is to love your neighbor as yourself. That's right. To love your neighbor as yourself. Very good. And what's the Great Commission? All these kind of sound alike, but we're getting them. What's the Great Commission? Jesus told his disciples to go and do what? To go and make disciples, right, of all the nations. How? Baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and then to teach them to do all that. Who commands?
God.
Jesus, God, right, commands, okay? So all that Jesus commands. The Great Commission is to, read it with me, go and make disciples of all the nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, teaching them to follow all that Jesus commands. That's right, all that Jesus commands. How many books are in the New Testament?
27.
Well, that was quick. You sure about that?
Yes.
All right, good. 27 books in New Testament. You ready? How many books in Old Testament?
39.
Oh, man, you guys are so good. You want to sing the New Testament books books fast or slow or super fast or super?
Super fast.
Nobody ever says super slow. You don't want to sing them super slow?
Like a slow?
Super fast? Okay. Super fast and super slow? All right, you ready? We'll try to go fast. Try to keep up with me. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Acts and letter to the Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, Galatians and Ephesians, Philippians, Colossians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Timothy, Titus and Philemon, Hebrews, James, 1st and 2nd Peter, 1st and 2nd and 3rd John, Jude and Revelation. You think we can go faster?
Yes.
We probably could, couldn't we? You want to go like really, 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 really fast?
Yes.
Okay. Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, Revelation. That's good, honey. Right? That's good. So how many books in the Old Testament? 39. You want to say them with me? Okay, you can look at them. Okay, yeah, we'll slow these down a little bit. You ready? Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1st and 2nd Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles, Ezra, Nehemiah, Esther, Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, Song of Solomon, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, Ezekiel, Daniel, Hosea, Joel, Amos, Obadiah, Jonah, Micah, Nahum, Habakkuk, Zephaniah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi. Very good. Very good. Give me a fruit. I heard you guys are scheming up here this morning. I may come over here and ask today, huh? What you got, Raymond?
A kiwi.
A kiwi. Whee! What you got, Evangeline? Lemon. A what? A carrot? That's fun. You want to crunch a carrot? That's what I think of. Yeah? Well, crunch a carrot. What you got?
Apple.
An apple? That's kind of the same noise, isn't it? We need to come up with a different noise, right? And way different, right? What you got? A tomato. I forget who likes tomatoes. Who likes tomatoes? Charlie likes tomatoes. Very good. Oh, no. Give me a fruit, Zoe. A chicken wing. Oh, goodness. Give me a fruit, Amelia. Bologna. You see what they're doing to me this morning? What you got, Brooklyn? A bell pepper. That's kind of fun, right? Are those the sweet ones? Bell pepper's kind of sweet. Yeah, that's fun. What you got? A cantaloupe. Very good. Have we done a cantaloupe? We have done a cantaloupe. Anytime I think of a cantaloupe, I think of how I don't like a cantaloupe. But my dad likes cantaloupes, right? Mr. Randy likes cantaloupes. What you got?
Pepper.
A pepper. Very good. Like a hot, spicy. Oh, that's a good one. Yeah. Like a ghost pepper. Oh, that's scary. What you got? A kiwi? Whee! We'll do a double kiwi. What do you got?
A hamburger.
A hamburger? Are you kidding me? I do like hamburgers. What do you got? A potato. I tell you what. I think Rob had something to do with that this morning. These kids up here scheming. What you got? A pomegranate. That's a good one. Aren't those the ones with little seeds in them and stuff? Do you eat the seeds? Do you? Man, learning all kinds of stuff this morning. Now, how are we going to do this? You ready? The fruit of the Spirit's not a kiwi, whee, or a kiwi, whee, or a carrot, or an apple, way different, or a tomato, Charlie likes tomatoes, or a chicken wing, or a bell pepper, or a bologna, right, or a cantaloupe, my dad likes cantaloupe, or a hot pepper, it's so hot, or a, what'd you say, kiwi, we did a double kiwi, or a hamburger. Get at it. Ooh, those are fun. A big, juicy hamburger. Or a potato. Mash them up and eat them, maybe. That's how you eat them. Or a pomegranate. I like that one, actually. We'll figure something good out for that one. The fruit of the Spirit's not any of that, okay? And if you want to be any of that, you might as well hear it. You can't be a fruit of the Spirit because the fruit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Whoa, whoa. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Very good. I had one of you guys yesterday ask me which one of those is my favorite. Which fruit of the Spirit is my favorite? That was you, wasn't it? Okay. I told them I like to work on self-control. Okay. But remember, these aren't all different. These are what happens to us. All of this is what happens to us when God's Spirit becomes who we are. Okay? When we let God's Spirit reign in us, then this is what we become. Say it with me one more time. We become love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and goodness and faithfulness and gentleness and self-control. Very good. Let's say our memory verse. Search me, O God. You ready for this one? Psalm 139. Search me, O God, and know my anxious thoughts and see if there is any... You got the next one for me up there, guys? See if there is any unclean way in me or hurtful way in me. Say it with me. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious thoughts, and see if there be any hurtful way in me, and lead me in the everlasting way. That's in your bulletin, written just like that, parents, if you want to take it home and look at it. In my Bible that I read, it's a little bit different, but still such a good verse. You guys are awesome. This is a great morning. Pray with me, and you guys can go back to your seats. You ready? Father, I'm very thankful for you. I'm thankful for Sundays. I'm thankful for the opportunity to start our gathering this way with kids that are excited and anxious to be here, anxious to even sit up front and talk about you and recite things about you. And I just always pray that this is more than just words on their lips. I pray that these are your truth that is taking deep root in their heart. And Father, I feel like the best way for that to happen is for them to see these truths modeled in me and in us. And so may we take that very serious, Father. May we be people who love you and adore you and follow you and are challenged by you and who have faith in you. And may our kids see that. And thank you for letting us see such wonderful love in them. Father, bless us in this time we're together today, and bless these kids as they worship and go to class and our opportunity just to be here with them. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Amen. See you guys. Good job.
To start with sympathy, Penny Browning and her family on the passing of her mom, Miss Irene Moss. Also, sympathy to Deborah Manning and her family on the passing of her dad, Mr. Roscoe Field. Also, sympathy to Nancy Glover, her brother Walter Elliott, wife passed away. And the funeral is tomorrow in Manchester.
Good morning, kickoff.
Thank you.
All right.
Is that better?
Is that better? Well, good morning. Y'all lip readers. Well, let me start all over. Sympathy. Penny Browning and family, the passing of her mom, Miss Irene Moss. Sympathy to Deborah Manning and family on the passing of her dad, Mr. Roscoe Fields. Also, sympathy to Nancy Glover, her brother Walter Elliott, his wife Diane passed away, and her funeral is tomorrow in Manchester. So please keep these families in your prayers. Kenny Whitaker had kidney stone surgery. He is home recovering. I think getting ready for a big surgery for a big stone a little later. Also, Lily Pinkerton, which is Eric Riddle's girlfriend, had surgery. She is recovering, and Amy says they hope to get her to a regular room today. So, as always, we've got lots of people to pray about. So, what's our encouragement card of the week is Amanda O'Kelly, and she came forward a couple weeks ago requesting prayers and encouragement card. Her address is in the bulletin. We encourage you to get a bulletin. It's got everything in it you need to know. Birthdays. Well, there'll be, as always, a study of John tonight. We'll resume. Last week we called it off for Mother's Day, but it'll resume tonight at 5. have 60 minutes of solid Bible study and lots of good discussion, we hope. And then Wednesday night, we'll be studying Psalm 65 at 7. Birthdays, 15th, Charlie Fowler, the 16th, Tatum Pryor, the 19th, Wyatt Curd, the 20th, Adeline Pryor, and the 21st, Kenny Manning. Anniversaries, the 19th, Jaron and Caitlin Clifton. Then each went to his own home, but Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. At dawn, he appeared again in the temple courts, where all the people gathered around him, and he sat down to teach them. The teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought in a woman caught in adultery. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law, Moses commanded us to stone such women. Now, what do you say?" They were using this question as a trap in order to have a basis for accusing him. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. When they kept on questioning him, he straightened up and said to them, "If any of you is without sin, let him be the first to throw a stone at her." Again, he stooped down and wrote on the ground. At this, those who heard began to go away one at a time, the older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman still standing there. Jesus straightened up and asked her, "Woman, where are they? Has no one condemned you?" "No one, sir," she said. "Then neither do I condemn you," Jesus declared. "Now go and leave your life of sin." Lord, I thank you that the only one who could throw a rock did not. Have mercy on us, O Lord. We sometimes are rock throwers, and we should be pelting ourselves. And I just pray that this morning we would all acknowledge that we are sinners, and if it were not for Jesus, we could not even approach you or be in your presence. And we thank you for him, and it is in his name we pray. Amen.
If you will, please be turning to number 275. 275, we'll sing the first and last verses, please. Grateful for our visitors this morning. Got a chance to see some people I hadn't seen in 30 plus years, and it's good to know that my hair is not the only person's hair who has turned white. It's good to see everyone here. 275, first and last verses.
I love to tell the story of unseen things
Song of encouragement this morning after the lesson. Now, if you will, please turn to number 185. When we reach that home and lay our burdens down, God shall wipe
those things that you do for us without our knowledge. Lord, we know that you watch over us. We know Our scripture reading today will be John chapter 1, verses 14 through 16. John chapter 1, verses 14 through 16. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness of Him and cried out, saying, "This was He whom I said, 'He who comes after me is preferred before me, for he was before me, and his fullness we have all received, and grace for grace.'"
Good morning, everybody. How are we doing today? We're going to do a little different today. Today's a little more of a class than a sermon because I want to show you some things that I think that will help. Come on through. That will help with your Bible study, especially those of you, we are New Testament Christians here, but we've been doing kind of a series on Jesus, and Stephen has been leading us through that in the book of Luke, and I've been trying the first half of this year to find Jesus in the Old Testament, and we've looked at some things like Abraham and Isaac, we've looked at some things in prophecy, we've looked at some things that are coming. I've got about two more lessons in this series in the month of June that I'm going to do, and then probably somewhere around August transition to something else. But this morning is a little more, like I said, class, because I've got to do some showing you of some things so that you better understand words that you read. I appreciate Mark's reading tonight. That's going to be his lesson. We'll talk a little about that in a minute. There should be a handout in your pew. If there's nobody in the pew in front of you, just grab that one. Share if you can, because this is something that I think will help you better understand some of your readings in the New Testament, as you also will understand some of your readings in the Old Testament. So let's kind of start our class slash sermon today as we go. So Exodus 25, 8 through 9. "And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them according to all that I show you. That is the pattern of the tabernacle and the pattern of all its furnishings, just so you shall make it." When the children of Israel are leaving, God says, "I want to make something that you will carry with you that shows you me, who I am and why I'm important, and even where I should be placed within this group." I think often we read about Jesus being at the temple. Mark read that Jesus was at the temple. I don't know that we picture that. I don't know that we see that. I think when we see the word tabernacle, we may not actually see what that looks like. And so I wanted to do that so we could better understand Hebrews chapters 9 and 10. And I promise we will get there. But before we get there, I want to look at some things that maybe you were unfamiliar with. And maybe it's this passage in the book of Numbers. In the book of Numbers, it says in chapter 23, 28, "So Balak took Balaam to the top of Peor, which overlooks the wasteland." And then you read on in 24, "He set his face toward the wilderness, and Balaam lifted up his eyes and saw Israel camping tribe by tribe, and the Spirit of God came upon him." You read a passage like that and you say, okay, big deal. Guy climbs mountain, looks down in valley, sees people camping. I do that. I've been to Gatlinburg. I've been to Pigeon Forge. Well, you've got to remember as you do that, that it might look a little different than you imagine. Some artists have represented it this way because, guys, it's possible there were close to 1 million people camping in that valley. Now, that's not something I've ever seen. I've been to stadiums and seen it full of several tens of thousands, but I don't know that I've ever seen 1 million people camp. And the midst of that camp would have been the tabernacle. And you say, well, why is that important? Because I think what Balaam sees here, some have said, looks a little more like this. When you get into this story and you look at what it has to say, you have to go back to Numbers chapter 2. And I know the book of Numbers is probably not your favorite. If I were to ask you to rank books of the Bible, ironically, when you put them in number excitement order, Numbers is probably down near the bottom. Why? Because it's a bunch of, anybody want to guess? It's in the title. Numbers. It's a bunch of numbers. And most of you, maybe you're good at math. Let me see how good you are at math. If I were to say, when was 1990? A lot of you say, oh, about 7 or 10 years ago. It was 30 years ago. Anybody depressed now? right? 1990 was 30 years ago. Don't anyone here say, that's when I was born. We don't like you, okay? We love you. We love you. We're glad you're here. Yeah, I mean, numbers is just not everybody's thing. Some of you deal with numbers in your work and where you do things in banking. But in Numbers chapter 2, God lays out something that Balaam would have seen all the way in Numbers 24. And it looks a little different for us, and so I thought we'd spend some time there kind of maybe looking at it. We're not going to read all that I'm about to put on the screen because, again, it's there. We can look at it some other time. But God is going to tell the children of Israel how to camp. They can't just camp anywhere. They have to camp in a specific place. You know, this morning you came in and you got to set where you want to set. I hope so. I hope nobody, like, made you move. But the children of Israel were to camp by tribes. And you'll notice that God even tells them which side of the tabernacle they can camp on. And so here was the east side, right? On the east side, here are the people, and here are their numbers, and this is how many of them were. And when you add up all the people on the east side, you've got about 186,400 men leading that group camping on that side. Now, again, that doesn't count everybody that's necessarily there. You can continue on in that, and you can go to the other side. We can go to the south side, for instance. When you go to the south side, you've got some tribes you probably recognize, like Reuben or Simeon or Gad, and they number about 151,450. Again, you can do the math. It's there in the Bible for you. And then you kind of look at the west side and the north side, and you'll see that there are other tribes camping there. So remember, I think when we see the Jews wandering in the wilderness, I always pictured as a kid that every day they packed up their stuff and they moved and they camped and they moved and they camped. No, they most likely stayed somewhere for a while. One, because the tabernacle had to be set up, and we'll see some of the complications of that. And also because it would not have been practical to stand up and move every day. Some of you don't do it. Some of you have lived in your house 20, 30, 40, 50 years. To move is just like this monumental thing, right? Well, they didn't do it all the time either. While, yes, they wandered in the wilderness, they did stay in camp from time to time for probably lengthy periods of time, probably until the flocks needed to move. And God would let them know when it was time to move. If you remember, he's going to be a fire at night and a cloud by day and say it's time to move. Well, what does all this have to do with that story that I started out over in later in Numbers? Well, it's very possible, and I didn't do the math on this, I'm relying on some other folks here. It's very possible that when you put the children of Israel on a chart, this is kind of who made up what percentage of the nation of Israel. And if you're familiar with Bible history, you know that some of these guys are older. They're the first sons. So they had a little longer time to get their families together. And then you look at people like Benjamin, who's the last son. He's got a little last time to get people together. And then you get Ephraim and Manasseh, who are sons of Joseph, and they've got even less time to get families started. Even though they were in Egypt for 400 years, they just never quite caught up. So those older sons have more of the people than do the younger sons or even that next generation. And I know even when you look at it something like this, you think, okay, I didn't come to church for a statistics class. Trust me, neither did I. But here's what I want to show you. When these people camp around that, it talks about where they are and which side they are. Numbers goes very much into depth. And so you can kind of divide them out into sections. So when Balaam goes up and sees the children of Israel camping, ladies and gentlemen, it's very possible he saw a scene kind of like the one I'm about to show you, because seeing a bunch of numbers in a book didn't help me. What helped me when somebody made it visual. Are you ready for them to camp? We're going to camp those on the different sides. And it's very possible we see Jesus in the Old Testament. It's very possible you would have seen the children of Israel's camp laid out like a cross. Now, they would have not have known that. They would not have recognized that. But in the heart of that cross is what I want you to see today, and that is the tabernacle. That is where God dwelt. And guys, as New Testament Christians, you know what is the heart of our cross? It is Jesus. It is where he dies. It is where blood was shed for his sin. It's very possible that this is the picture that was seen there. And again, we read that story and we just kind of say, okay, big deal. Guy climbs a mountain, looks at people camping. But it's very possible God was showing in the Old Testament what was to come. We've seen that already with the story of Jesus. Those of you who are familiar with Bible stories know that that happens. And so what you might have seen was something more like this. Now, I don't think Balaam understood what he saw, and I don't think the children of Israel, when they set that camp up, understood what they saw. But I think God was trying to say something more is coming. And at the heart of it will always be me. Guys, that's what the tabernacle was to the children of Israel. It was their representation of God. And so today, our representation of God is Jesus. And he is supposed to be at the center of us. He's the center of our lives. He's the center of our worship. He's the center of our service in a few moments. And so when he climbs and he sees those people camping, it's very likely this is the view that he saw. I say that because we read things in the Old Testament, obviously, and sometimes we kind of glance over them. It's very possible the book of Numbers you have glanced through. Some of you may have read it in its entirety. It may be your favorite book. Someone may come up to me afterwards and say, hey, I love Numbers. Awesome. Let's sit down. Will you teach it to me? But in seeing something like this, that means there's probably more to see in the Old Testament when it comes to what is coming in God's plan. Well, it probably, again, looked a little bit like this. And so I just wanted to show that to you and to kind of make you think today that there may be times you're reading in the Old Testament and God is revealing what is coming, but we don't always see it because we haven't either slowed down to look at it or we may just not understand exactly what God is saying there. I don't know where you parked this morning, but if you parked this morning, you may have thought the children of Israel were camping over here. I don't know where all of you came and entered the building at, but as you leave today, if you leave out this side or if you drive up the road at some point, you're going to see some things that might look like places for tents to go. Well, they're not tents. All right, let me tell you, nobody's going to camp, but I don't guess. Yesterday, some people worked, and this week some people worked to put in some raised planting beds across the road here in our field. It's right around the volleyball court, so it might look a little bit like the children of Israel camping. And they did that to begin to lay the groundwork for what's coming in June, Vacation Bible School. Our Vacation Bible School this year has kind of an odd title, right? Farm Fresh. Now, Mark, when I think of Farm Fresh, I think of a smell, okay? My granddaddy had a farm. Yeah, not you personally. So Farm Fresh kind of caught me off guard there a little bit. But it's going to be a great story of God's creation, the parable of the sower, several things in the Bible that apply to God and growth. And so I hope it's something that you'll go ahead and dedicate some time and attention to. Well, one of the things we want to do is go ahead and plant some things out there. So in the next few weeks, when we have Farm Fresh, we may actually have some things out there to show some of the kids. Some people are working really hard to put some things together. Make sure you have those dates down now. It is a Friday, a Saturday, and a Sunday. That may be a little different. I know there have been times we've done VBS during the week at night, but last year we did it on a weekend. We're going to do it on a weekend. We'll have the times for you. Friday will be kind of at night. Saturday will be during the day, and Sunday will be kind of like our service here. And I think we're staying and eating afterwards and maybe doing some things. So it might look just a little different. We'll get those times to you, but I want you to go ahead and get that in your calendar. We'd love to have you help. Speaking of class, guys, we have a great group of kids here. Everything from teens to preteens to young kids. And today, let me just go ahead and tell you, they're having class. And today's story is David and Goliath. And we were able to get Bill Curd to play Goliath. Now, if you don't know Bill Curd, you saw him standing here. If he had been standing up there, I mean, you kind of get the idea of what Goliath is. So those of you on this side of the building, if you hear shouting outside in a minute, it's going to be Bill Curd, okay? He's going to be Goliath outside and show the kids how tall he was, and we've got some equipment that we put on him to kind of make him look like, you know, he's. So if your kids come back crying, that's your problem, not ours, all right? But you may hear that over there. You may hear some stuff outside today. I promise nothing. Everything's good out there. But guys, we've had a wonderful opportunity to teach our kids and let our kids see some things and do some things. I hope you are interacting with our kids after service when they come back. Parents, ask them about the craft that they made. Ask them about what the story was. Those of you who don't have kids, interact with them. Ask, say, hey, what was the story today? Now, let me tell you, kids are a little bit like the old story that I've told before about the kid who came home from Sunday school class. And his mother said, what did you learn today? And she said, oh, Mom. The kid said, it was a great story. Mom, they talked about this guy named Moses who led these children of Israel out of Egypt. And all of a sudden they got to this sea and there were mountains on both sides and Pharaoh's army was behind them and they didn't know what they were going to do. And the mom says, oh, tell me the story. He said, oh, it was fantastic. He said, Moses called in the Corps of Engineers and they laid down a bridge across that water. And they walked right across that bridge and got to the other side. And then he called in attack helicopters. And they came in and blew up that bridge while Pharaoh's army was on there and sunk Pharaoh's army. And his mother said, "Is that what they taught you in Sunday school?" He said, "No, but if I tell it the way they tell it, you're never going to believe that story." So that's kind of how kids are. Guys, ask our kids what they are doing. Those of you as adults, thank you. You are rotating in and out. You're getting to be in here a part of the time, and you're giving at least a month or 2 months of the year to be with our kids. And I want some of you to hear that. Not a lifetime. 1 or 2 months, try it. Guys, there are several things you can do down there. There is lesson, there is craft, and there is encouragement time. The kids start out with a lesson, they do a craft, and then they're taken into a room where sometimes they're signing cards or they're being asked things we ought to pray about as a church. Go listen to what kids think ought to be prayed about. So many times as adults, we forget what some of those things are. So if you want to be a part of that program, if you will see me or Stephen or Tracy or somebody, we'll get you in rotation. We'll get you in rotation. Watch those kids when they come out. And so you're kind of getting your class today. And just want to remind you about VBS coming up. We've already started meeting about it. You haven't missed anything yet. If you want to be a part of it, we still need people to do crafts and people to walk kids around and make sure they get across the street safely. Probably pop some corn, all kinds of things. You'll be hearing more about it. So please listen up for that. And I do want to remind you about tonight. Tonight, remember, we have a Bible class. It is all ages. It is all ages Bible class on the book of John. Already the scripture was read from John 8 this morning of what we're going to talk about tonight. And so I'm sure Mark is putting that in his brain and then he wants some comment from you. It's a very well-known story. I hope you'll be here as we're here on 5 o'clock to do that. And just open the Bible and just kind of talk about what it is. We meet in the fellowship hall. You got your table. Bring your Bible. Bring some paper. You know, you can take notes there, those kinds of things. But hope you'll be a part of that as well as our Wednesday night studies. Guys, we're pretty much back to full schedule. A lot of things going on. We had Sing Out here last night. Wonderful, wonderful opportunity to come. Had about 100 people filling this room singing and praising God. Kind of got me ready for today, and I hope it did for you. So again, this summer is going to be a fantastic summer Bible camp. I mean, I can just start laying out things that are coming up. Clothing drive. We are going to have a great summer here. So please start watching your bulletin. Catch the things online. Remember, your bulletin's online at www.olduncoc.com. And if you don't have some of the things I present today, they're also there for you. You can also find some of that information there. Let's get back into God's Word. I just want to take a little break because I kind of just presented you with something that was a little heady, a lot of numbers. I want to show you the tabernacle for just a moment. I want to show you at least an artist representation of the tabernacle, what it probably most likely looked like. Tracy and I were privileged several years ago to be in Pennsylvania. In Pennsylvania, in Amish country, they have built a life-size replica of the tabernacle. I wish I could remember the name, but if you Google, you'll be able to find it. And you can go and see what it looked like size-wise. Size-wise, the compound, not the tabernacle, the compound's about the size of this room, not exactly. And the tabernacle would sit kind of, for our discussion today, on that end of the room down there. And they would have put this up, like I said, done their worship there. It would have stayed there. Then God would have said it's time to move, and they would have packed it all up. Remember, God did this so that he could dwell with them. Will you put that in the back of your mind for a moment, that God wanted to dwell with you? What if I came to you today and I said, "Look, Tracy and I have been thinking, and of all the people here, we want to live at your house today." And some of you would say, "You do not want to live at my house." Right? You have no, I mean, it's the end of the school year. This is going on. Or you say, "Oh, wow, you know, I really wished I knew you were coming." You know, what does it mean when God wants to dwell? God wanted to live among the people. And so the tabernacle is an example where God is trying to live among the people. I hope already you're understanding the things that God is going to do when it comes to Jesus coming down and being with us. And then again, he wants to dwell there. And so the 12 tribes camped on the four sides. And then inside that tabernacle was all kinds of things. We're going to look at those things very briefly today, and then I promise I'm going to tie it into your New Testament. So if you'll stay with me for a little bit today, I told you it's a little more class than sermon. That's just kind of where we're at to better help you understand your scripture. So the tabernacle, it's a tent. That's what tabernacle basically is. And God wanted to dwell, and he chose a tent because a tent's not really permanent. Most of you have not lived in a tent permanently. There are people who do. We need to think about those people in our society. But most of us may have been camping or in some type of thing that was a temporary location. As you would have approached that, there would have been things around the courtyard. You couldn't see right into the courtyard. There would have been a tent-like structure, a wall around it. Maybe some of you have been to places where people put up, so you had to, like, to get in, you had to go inside to see what was happening. And so you would enter that, and there, you could only enter it one way. Are you with me, Jesus, in the Old Testament? You could only enter it one way, and that was through the gate. And Jesus will often say things like, what? I am the door. Do you get it? I am the door, right? No one enters except through me. Are you seeing Jesus in the Old Testament? And so you've entered this courtyard through this gate here, or through this fabric here. And again, they were blue and purple and scarlet and white, and there have been four pillars of brass. I mean, it would have been shiny. You wouldn't have missed the entrance. Any of you ever been somewhere and missed the entrance? I heard years ago that there was a big box store on one end of a strip mall, and there was a big box store on the other end of strip mall, and in between them was this tiny little store. And everybody thought that tiny little store is going to go bankrupt. You know, no one's going to go to that store. And the store owner had a great idea. He just put above his door, entrance. Right? Entrance. So everybody went to his store, right? Before they went to the other store. Well, this is the entrance. This is where you go in. And so once you went in, what would we have seen in that courtyard? Well, I think that's a valid question. It might have looked like this. These are artists' representations. We don't have pictures. I know kids are always amazed that we don't have pictures of things in the past because they have like 60 of them from yesterday. But we don't have pictures of the past. And so you would have seen the altar, you would have seen the laver, and you would have seen the tabernacle, right? This actual tent structure that God had asked them to build. Well, let's kind of break that down real quick. There are several things there. The altar, the laver, and the tabernacle. And so let's just kind of look real quickly. The altar is going to be made of wood, but it's going to be covered in metal, right? It's going to be covered in bronze. It's got four corners, and they were kind of like horns. You might remember there's times in the Bible where it says we're not supposed to swear by this or by that or by the horns of the altar. Well, that's what they meant. People would say, well, I will say this and swear by the horns of the altar, and people know that what I have to say is true. No, the Bible says what? Let your yes be yes, or your no be no. Swearing on something, you know, a stack of Bibles or grandmother's grave, is not going to make you more truthful. You're either going to be a truthful person or you're not. And so these were the horns of the altar, you may have read other places. And there they had all these furnishings made out of bronze. Some of you may remember having a fireplace. And remember, you always, if you have a fireplace, you got to have that little thing that stands beside it that has a shovel and a poker and some other things that you never use, but they looked real pretty, didn't they? Well, these were used, right? These were used in the sacrifice. They would have been there. And there would have been a grate so that as you burned, the ashes fell through. So guys, when they pick up the altar to move it, what's left behind is a big pile of ash. Ash. All their sins they leave behind. How about you this morning when you leave here? Did you plan to come and leave something behind? A worry, a fear, maybe a sin? But that's what's going to happen when they move that altar. And so they're going to have offerings there. And remember, they're going to bring the best. And I think you know that already. We talked about the Passover lamb. Remember a few weeks ago, I had a little stuffed lamb up here. And we talked about Jesus in the Old Testament being a part of the Passover. And we talked about how to be clean and spotless. And again, it was something of worth and value. And they would take and they would do that. And again, they're not going to eat of this lamb. It is totally a sacrifice. It does nothing other than cover their sin. And there were other offerings that might be given there. I think sometimes we forget that animals are not the only thing offered. In the John class a couple of weeks ago, we talked about a drink offering that was poured on the altar to remember the time they wandered in the wilderness, and they poured water on the altar to remember the time that God made water come from the rock. They also put grain on the altar sometime, which I find fascinating that these people are burning grain when they are wanderers. Are you with me, church? While they do not have a harvest yet. They're relying on God to provide them manna and quail. And they actually take, I mean, how many of you would take your lunch at work and burn some of it knowing that God would still provide you with enough to eat? I mean, that you know, say, okay, well, I'll cut the crust off my bread because I didn't want that anyway. No, this is, again, stuff that you would have been first fruits, right? It would have been important to you. And so we see grain offerings going on in there also. And then the priests washed themselves in something called a laver. It's basically a bronze bowl with water, but what you may not know is this bronze was donated by the women of Israel. The women of Israel donated their bronze mirrors, and they melted them down, and they made a laver. They made a laver where the priest would go and wash himself before he entered into the tabernacle. Guys, water has always, are you with me, church? Water has always been a part of God's story. I would love to do a whole series on just where water is a part of God's story. Everything from coming out of rock to the Spirit moving over the face of the deep to baptism. Water has always been a part of God's story. And here in the tabernacle, we see that. They would have washed themselves in this bronze laver. And remember, as they're washing, this is made out of metallic bronze for mirrors, which means it's the best, it's the shiniest. Something most of us are probably unfamiliar with is the mirror that you looked in today, the mirror that you looked in today, didn't really come around until the 1400s. We've only really had mirrors like you looked in today with the silver backing or whatever they use today, the mercury backing, since about the 1400s. That's why, again, I don't want to get off in the history, but I think we forget, again, those folks aren't like us. Guys, the first time people actually saw themselves clearly wasn't until the 1400s or 1500s. That's why we get self-portraits in that time period. That's why today you can take a selfie. You ever realize your face is the only part of you your eyes really can't see, right? Your face is the only part. I mean, you have to rely on others to say you look good today if you didn't have what? A mirror. So these women melt their mirrors down, and this is their contribution. Women are a part of that. And so the priest will wash himself here to go prepare himself. And as he does so, he has to look at himself. And just because he's washed the outside and is ready to go for preparation, has he washed the inside? How about you this morning? In a moment, as a part of our service, we're asking you to look inside. We're asking you to take some elements. They're not reflective, but they are reflective because we are reflecting on what they mean. But are they changing our inside? Right? They're not elements that are going to be put on the outside of us today as we leave. They're elements that are going to be put on the inside of us because of who we have taken on as our Lord and our Savior. And so as they washed themselves, they had to look at themselves. When's the last time you took a good look at yourself? And I know you had a mirror this morning. Now, you know I'm not talking about that. As we go to partake today, are you looking at yourself? And so that's what would have been there in the courtyard, in the outside. So you would have the altar, you would have the laver. And then you get to the actual tabernacle, the tent, right? Well, what's that all about? Well, guys, it's a lot more complicated. It's about 45 feet by 15 feet, so not really that big. Not really that big, right? It has to be portable. But it's made of lots of parts, walls that disconnect, that are covered in gold. Where they get the gold? The Egyptians gave it to them. They said, get out of here. Here's our gold. You might remember later, earlier they'd used that gold for idol worship. But now they're using it to line the inside of the tabernacle on these wooden walls that come down and reassemble. You also notice that it's divided into two sections, right? A holy and a most holy. And a lot of you are familiar with that with your study of the temple. And not only that, though, guys, this is extremely elaborate. Again, I'm not going to go into all the details today because I really want to make sure you walk home with a lesson today. But understand that there were 48 boards, 100 sockets, 98 of them made out of silver. I mean, God had a plan. He didn't just say, go get a tent from Coleman and put it up and pretend I'm in there. God had a thought process here. Guys, God is not a God that does not use thought process or planning. And so he planned out what the tabernacle should look like. He wanted to represent himself. So things of gold and silver valuable to the Egyptians to worship their gods would be valuable to the Israelites because they would give it to their God to represent him. And then you would have gone inside the tabernacle. Now you would not have been allowed. I would not have been allowed. I'm not a Levite. I'm not a priest. But we're going to go in there today for the purpose of this study very quickly. And there inside the holy place would have been walls lined in gold. Imagine today you had come in and all these walls instead of paint were lined in gold. Well, that's important because inside there are several items, like the lampstand. Guys, imagine a lamp into the side of that tabernacle on lit up, and it's bouncing off that gold. It would have lit up the room just like we have electricity today. And there on the other side is a table of showbread. We'll talk about that real quickly. And there's an altar of incense. So it might look something like that. And again, I promise that we are getting somewhere where this is going to make some sense. They would have had this golden candlestick, and it's there to provide light in darkness. Think about it, in a tent with multiple layers of fabric over it, with wooden walls, it would have been dark in there. But God did not want us to enter into darkness. God wanted us to enter and walk according to what? Light. Jesus in the Old Testament. You might even remember in John chapter 8, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." They didn't know that's what that was, but God was beginning to put physical representation of something spiritual that was coming. And then there would have been the table of the showbread. This shows up several times in the Bible. Once David's men eat from this table and they get in a little bit of trouble, and you can look that up. But the table of showbread was where they would put out 12 loaves of bread every day. Every day there were 12 loaves of bread, and not always every day, excuse me, but they would put 12 loaves of bread, and it represented the 12 tribes. Now, I had never made this connection before until recently, but there were 12 loaves of bread. Does anyone remember when Jesus fed the 5,000 how many baskets of leftovers they took up? 12. 12 baskets of leftovers. Guys, I think Jesus was showing, I am now the tabernacle. I now dwell among you. And remember, in this table of showbread, what we eat becomes a part of our being. Guys, that's why God calls us together once a week to remind ourselves of who we are and who we should be. Not at the end of the week so we can live in guilt and say, "Oh, I wish I'd been better," but at the beginning of the week so that we can go out and be better. And so we will gather around a table. At the other end of that, before you went into the next, was the altar of incense. Now, we don't have incense in here today. Some of you might have a little too much cologne. I don't know. Hopefully you put deodorant on. But this would have been a thing to make it smell good in there. And these would have represented the prayers going up to God, right? Remember, just to go back to John 6:35, Jesus once says, "I am the bread of life." And there would have been the altar of incense. And I don't know if you remember, but in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 15 through 17, it talks about how we are the aroma of Christ. Guys, when we leave here, we're supposed to go and people smell something different in the world. Now, I don't mean people are going to come up to you this week and smell you. If so, that's another issue. But your workplace ought to be different because you're a Christian in that workplace. Your workplace ought to smell and be different because you're a Christian in that school. Or you're a Christian in whatever it is you are doing or where you find yourself today. And so there would have been the altar of incense. And that would have been all the things in the holy place. And then there would have been the most holy. Now, we all know this one. We all know this one, probably less from Bible, but because of a movie, right? And the movie is what? Raiders of the Lost Ark. But you couldn't see the ark. There was a veil there. Even in the tabernacle, there was a veil there. And there was a barrier because you could not approach God directly. There was a barrier between you and God. And so the priest could go in there and the priest could approach God for you, which puts you separated. And what had separated God is going to be very much in our story in VBS at the beginning, the garden. And it's sin. And it's sin. And that veil represented the sin that kept us from being able to approach God directly. And so it's made there, and you can read all the details. I promise all this is online. But this is, if you could have gone in that, what you have seen, the Ark of the Covenant. Again, artist representation. Don't really know what it looks like. And there in those gold walls would be that gold ark, and the priests would go in to take care of those things. Now, you would see the ark occasionally because they have to pack all this up and march it with the children of Israel. And in this most holy place, that's what would have been there. The most holy place was where God was represented. The most holy place. But it was separated by a veil. I say all that this morning to get to this point, and that is inside that ark were some very important items that the children of Israel had collected. They had collected a jar of manna to remind themselves that God had fed them. Again, I am the bread of life. They had kept in there the original, not the original Ten Commandments, Moses had destroyed those, but the ones that he would make so they could remember God as a God of law. And would have been Aaron's rod that buds, something dead that comes to life. And so, folks, as we gather around the table this morning, we are reminded, are we living according to the commandments that God gives? Right? Were we something dead to sin, but now are alive in Christ? And God provides bread. Remember, Jesus says, "I am the bread." Well, those are all the things that would have been in that ark. And you say, well, Daryl, you know, this has been a great preview of what everything looked like. How does this relate to me today? I get it. And I want to thank you for letting me get us to that point. Let's go to the book of Hebrews and close there. Hebrews in the New Testament. As a kid, I always thought Hebrews was in the Old Testament, right? Because it is about Jewish Christians. The other thing before you get there is remember you would have seen a cross within a cross. The way these things were laid out, an offering, water for cleanliness, an aroma, a bread, a light, a holy place. All those also would have been laid out as almost a cross within a cross, long before we ever saw something like this. And here's where I close us today in Hebrews chapters 8 and 9. This is what the whole thing was about. I told you it was more class than sermon. Stick with me just a few more minutes. But in the book of Hebrews, it says some things about the tabernacle. And if you're a New Testament Christian and you've read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and now you know the teachings of Jesus, and you're wanting to know what else you need to know, you're going to find yourself in the book of Hebrews. And I don't want you to just read through the book of Hebrews and say, well, I don't even get any of this stuff. A lot of us don't because we don't come from Jewish background. Guys, Jesus is our high priest. It was Jesus who was able to do away with that veil, and we'll look at that in just a moment. And here's what it says in Hebrews chapter 9. He went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle that is not man-made. Jesus is our tabernacle. Jesus dwells with us. He comes from heaven and lives in a temporary thing we call a body. We act like it's going to last forever. And he dwells among the people. And when he goes, the disciples go. And when he stops, the disciples stop. And he entered through the most holy place once and for all through his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. Remember, Jesus did not rely on the blood of bull and goats. It was going to be his own blood that would be shed. It would not be on an altar, but be on a cross. And in Hebrews 9 and 11, it says, but when Christ appeared as a high priest of the good things to come, he entered through the greater and more perfect tabernacle, not made with hands, that is to say, not of this creation. Jesus is God made, for he is God. But Jesus has been since creation, as we will learn in VBS. But when Christ appeared as that high priest, again, not only made, not made with hands, verse 12, and not through the blood of goats and calves, but through his own blood, he entered the holy place once for all, having obtained eternal redemption. No more do we have to meet once a year for the Day of Atonement and have our sins forgiven. They are forgiven when we are baptized. They are forgiven when we are baptized and raised to walk that new life, and we continue to have that through repentance and grace. And as you continue to read there in Hebrews, for if the blood of goats and bulls sanctify for the cleansing of the flesh, how much more will the blood of... Guys, if they believe that the blood of animals could do it, do we not believe the blood of the Son of God is much more? Much more. Who offered himself without blemish to God, cleanse your conscience from the dead works to serve the living God. God is no longer living in a tent, but he is a living God awaiting us to take to heaven and living in our daily lives. Remember when Jesus cries out on the cross in John 19:20, he says, it is finished. Do you remember what happened in the temple? The temple, very much like the tabernacle, the veil was ripped. No longer was God hidden. You can approach God. Have you ever thought about that? Any of you ever seen someone in public that was famous and you were afraid to approach them because you said, oh, you know, they don't really know who I am? I used to work in the country music industry years ago, and I would watch people who wanted to ask for autographs but weren't sure if they should, right? I mean, somebody would be sitting there eating at a table at a restaurant, and you could see people would kind of like walk around and try to get, you know, hoping the person would realize why they were there. And sometimes they didn't. They weren't being rude. They just didn't see them. Guys, we don't approach a God who doesn't see us. No longer is God hidden between the veil. The veil is gone, and we approach God. This morning, if there's something you need to approach God with, will you please do so? And it doesn't require a bull or a goat or a grain offering or a drink offering or a tabernacle. It involves a repentant heart. It involves you wanting to be different and better and to be in the presence of that God. Remember, at that moment, the veil is torn. But I want to go back to Hebrews 10 for just a minute. We have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus. Guys, you can approach what we're going to do here in a few moments because of the blood of Jesus, a new and living way open for us through the curtain that is His body. There's nothing between you and God anymore except you. Are you listening, church? There's nothing between you and God anymore except you. You. Have you given yourself to Him? Have you realized that He wants you in the most holy of places? That He wants communion with you? That He wants to travel with you, not just here, but in the next stage we call eternity? That's a God that wants relationship. I also saw country music stars who stood there hoping someone would ask them for an autograph. And guess what? Some people didn't even recognize them and know who they are. Guys, how many times does God do things in our life and we haven't given credit where the credit is? I close with these things this morning. We have been made holy through the sacrifice of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all. No more tabernacles. No more tents. Guys, you are holy because of what Jesus has done. Not because of what a priest did for you. Not because of an offering. Not because of a tent. Not because of anything else that you read. You are holy because of what Jesus did for you. And this verse was read recently. Joe put this as a part of his communion devotional, and he brought out this point. The Word became flesh. That's what it says in John, and that was our reading today. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Do you know the word dwelt there is the same word that means tabernacle? Jesus came to tabernacle, to tent with us. But He was only here for a time. He was only here for a time. It is His teachings that are supposed to stay, and His communion, and His forgiveness, and His grace that we celebrate today. I told you today was more class than sermon, but I think that if I don't tell you some things, I would be amiss. Guys, the tabernacle was a blueprint for God's relationship with the Old Testament. I'm not asking anyone to go out today and rebuild a tabernacle. I'm not asking us to take this field and turn it into something that, no. But I do know that God has a blueprint. God does have a system that He wants that you to be saved. I don't know if it's your first time ever at a church. That's possible in a room like this. Some of you have been Christians a long time, and I know you may have come today wanting more of a sermon. You may have wanted me to rail on sinners because you think you aren't one. You may have wanted to come today and hear something that made you feel good. What I really want you to get out of today is God is a planning God. God is a planning God. And God has a plan that doesn't involve a tent or an altar or the things that we looked at today. Why did we look at them? Because Jesus was that tabernacle. He came to dwell with us. And while He was here, He shed His blood. Not on an altar behind a curtain that we couldn't see, but He did it because He was lifted up so that all men might be drawn to Him. Maybe you've heard the words of Jesus before today. If you haven't and that's why you came, please don't leave without talking to us. If you came today because you needed to know more about Jesus, we do that here. Today was a little different day. We were looking at Jesus in the Old Testament. We'll be looking at Jesus tonight at 5 o'clock. Come join us there. But maybe you've heard those words, and maybe you begin to, but maybe you're seeing that God has had a plan, yes, from creation to Christ, to have a relationship with you. And then all He asks is that you repent, that you stop trying to do it your way, and you stop trying to figure it out on our earthly terms. And instead, you confess that Jesus Christ is the Son of a living God, a true God, not one that lives in tents and is in clouds and fire, although He is there, but one that is still here and omnipresent and doing things in people's lives that we can't ever imagine and some of us will never know, including ourselves. And He asks you to be baptized, to be washed. The death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. To be baptized for the forgiveness of your sin, to examine yourself today. For we are all sinners, and we've all come short of the glory of God. And then in doing that, live differently. Guys, the children of Israel were called to live differently. And maybe that's the one you're struggling with. Maybe you did okay. You know, putting up the tent was easy. Building some of the things of the tent might have been easy. But the teachings of the tent, that might have been the hard part. And so I ask, as you go out into a world this week, will it be a little lighter? Will people be a little more full? Will it smell and look differently because you have the aroma of Christ? Do people at your work know that you see the world in a different way and you interact with it in a different way because you're expecting a different outcome than just to have it all end? That's what I ask on a day like today. I thank you for sticking with me. But more importantly, I want you to stick with God. And today I don't call you to a tabernacle, but I call you to make a decision. And that is, do you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of a living God? In a moment, some of you will celebrate. But before we do, I want to give someone a chance to acknowledge as we stand and as we sing.
Have you been to Jesus? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in His grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood?
Oh, right. So have you ever done anything wrong? Have you ever sinned, and there was something that brings back memories of that, like a sound or a smell, a certain place, a certain time, a day or a month? The sound of a rooster crowing probably sent shivers down Peter's spine for the rest of his life. The disciple likely carried around the guilt and shame with him forever. If you would, turn to Luke 22. Luke 22, verses 31. We're going to start there. And we're going to revisit that fateful night in the life of Peter when he denied Jesus. Luke 22:31. Simon, Simon, look out. Satan has asked to sift you like wheat, but I have prayed for you that your faith may not fail, and you, when you have turned back, strengthen your brothers. Lord, he told him, I'm ready to go with you both to prison and to death. I tell you, Peter, he said, the rooster will not crow today until you deny me three times. And if you'll jump down to verse 54. And as they seized him and led him away, talking about Jesus, and brought him into the high priest's house. Meanwhile, Peter was following at a distance. They lit a fire in the middle of the courtyard and sat down together. And Peter sat among them. And when a servant saw him sitting in the light and looked closely at him, she said, this man was with him too. But he denied it. Woman, I don't know him. After a little while, someone else saw him and said, you're one of them too. Man, I am not, Peter said. About an hour later, another kept insisting, this man, it was certainly with him, since he's also a Galilean. But Peter said, man, I don't know what you're talking about. And immediately, while he was still speaking, a rooster crowed. Then the Lord turned and looked at Peter. So Peter remembered the word of the Lord and how he said to him, before the rooster crows today, you will deny me three times. And he went outside and wept bitterly. So that has to be pretty rough. Can you imagine living with that guilt the rest of your life? As followers of God, life is not easy. We haven't done ourselves any favors in that department. Not only are we unforgiving to ourselves for past sins, we can be very quick to bring up the past of others to make ourselves feel better, and most likely those sins, ours and others, have already been repented of and forgiven by God. Jesus' blood has washed those sins away. So this week, I've been living under a rock, obviously. I was introduced to a song titled Don't Thank Jesus by Morgan Wallen. And it's a catchy song. And it wasn't until I was working on this devotional that I listened to the words and followed along with the lyrics. And it really kind of hit home to me. And I felt like it meshed in really well with this devotional, and then Mark's prayer at the beginning of the service, talking about casting stones. It all comes together, and that's how cool God is. Like, everything is working. And so I'm going to read the lyrics real quick, slightly modified. So if you'll just bear with me. He says, a boy gets a guitar and starts writing songs about whiskey and women and smoking. He got all three things at his first show he played, and the hometown said, I don't think Jesus done it that way. Boy moves to the city, lives fast and goes hard, starts chasing devil through honky-tonk bars, ignoring the voices in his head that say, I don't think Jesus done it that way. If I was him, speaking of Jesus or God, I'd say, to heck with you, ain't no helping you. Find someone else to give heaven to. I'm telling you, I'd shame me, I'd blame me, I'd make me pay for my mistakes. But I don't think Jesus does it that way. Boy's all alone, got no one to turn to. He figures he'll pray, because what else could he do? He said, I wish you would have woken me up an easier way, but I don't think Jesus does it that way. If I was him, I'd say to heck with you, ain't no helping you, find someone else to give heaven to. I'm telling you, I'd shame me, I'd blame me, I'd make me pay for my mistakes, but I don't think Jesus does it this way. The world likes to rear back and throw a few stones. So the boy wants to throw a few stones of his own. But Lord knows I ain't perfect, and it ain't my place, and I don't think Jesus done it that way. Are y'all sure that Jesus done it that way? So, like, I hear that, and I feel like that's us, you know. And I can only speak for me, though, for the longest time and on occasion still, I think, you know, God, why would he want anything to do with me? Why do I even try? And the world has a nice way of bringing back our past and all the mistakes we've made. But I don't think Jesus does it that way. And can you see Peter feeling that way after denying Christ? No forgiveness for himself, shaming himself and blaming himself for what he had done. But this is the cool part. What if Peter chose a different response than blaming himself? What if instead of feeling guilt every time a rooster crowed, Peter chose to be reminded, I messed up, but I'm forgiven. The message of Jesus isn't one of condemnation, but of forgiveness. Amen. So today, as we take this bread and this fruit of the vine, and as we're reminded of Christ's body on the cross and Jesus' blood poured out for us, let us not wallow in guilt and remorse for our failures. Instead, let us take time to be thankful that we are forgiven by the grace of God and the blood of Jesus Christ. So would you pray with me, please? God, thank you so much. Thank you so much that you work in such a way that, like, everything, if we put our mind to it, it works together for your glory. Studying to put together a devotional and a country music song you've never heard of, and then an elder getting up and reading a verse that means so much to him, and it all weaves together. I just pray that we all, as we partake this bread, we think of the sacrifice that was made so that we have a reason to not feel shame and guilt, because we know that we're forgiven, God. Bless this bread. Bless this family. It's in Christ Jesus' name. Amen. Would you bow with me again? Father God, again, we thank you so much for Christ. Thank you so much for the example he lived, the perfect life he lived, but also the example he set for us, that nobody's perfect. And even though he was perfect, he didn't look down upon those that were not. I pray that we all take that into our lives, into this world, to show grace to others as you've shown grace to us, God. Bless this cup. Thank you for the blood of Christ. It's through his name we pray. Amen.
you're visiting with us again, we're glad you're here. Invite you back at every opportunity you may have to worship with us. If there's nothing further, if you would, please stand. We'll sing the greatest of man and then be dismissed in prayer.
Love one another.
So real quick, before the closing prayer, we went to a funeral this last week, for the grandson of a guy that worked with us, and he had leukemia, and his grandson was 13, and the pastor that was leading the service, he said he could sum this up in three words, and it's hurt, help, and hope. And so as people that know God, there's a lot of people in this world that only know the first one, you know? And so go into all the world. There's purpose for that, and it's to bring help, who the helper is, and hope. And so you guys pray with me, please. Father, I'm so thankful to be in a place with a people that we can be ourselves and be real and talk about how you work differently in our lives and help each other, learn from each other, encourage each other. It's just good to be part of a family of people that know you and that love you. And I pray that you burden our hearts for people that don't know you, and I pray that for the ones of us that do know you, then you encourage our hearts knowing how big you are and walking with us, like Daryl, big enough to be all that each one of us needs. And so I pray that you open our eyes up to opportunities to be like you with people that we come into contact with in our lives, in our jobs, at school. I pray that we can be people that live lives of help and hope. And so I'm just thankful for you. I'm so thankful for you, and I'm thankful for people that believe in you and that change for you and that walk with you and that are there for us to walk with. And so I'm just thankful, and we love you. In Jesus' name, amen.